فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما ينفعنا ولا تجعل فيما علمتنا وبالا علينا. إن شاء الله تعالى. It's the wrong time to lose your voice. And I've lost my voice. Inshallah ta'ala, it seems to be coming back. Bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. I, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, will be teaching another book in this program, which we named previously Precision in Knowledge. Precision in Knowledge. And this book, inshallah ta'ala, is the famous book known as Matn al-Jurumiyyah. This book, my beloved brothers and sisters, is the first book that the scholars teach when they want to teach grammar. Do you want to study grammar? Do you want to learn grammar? This is the first book in which you study. Now, inshallah ta'ala, before I start the book, there are a couple of points which I want to mention, okay? The first thing that a person should know before he starts a field is something which the scholars call Mabadi'ul Ashara, which is basically 10 points before you study that field. They summarized it in 3 lines of poetry. إِنَّ مَبَادِئَ كُلَّ فَنٍ عَشَرَةٍ الْحَدُّ وَالْمَوْضُوعُ ثُمَّ ثَمْرَةٍ إِنَّ مَبَادِئَ كُلَّ فَنٍ عَشَرَةٍ الْحَدُّ وَالْمَوْضُوعُ ثُمَّ ثَمْرَةٍ ها؟ وَالْإِسْمُ الْإِسْتِمْدَادُ لا والاسم ونسبة وفضل والواضع والاسم الاستمداد حكم شارع مسائل بالبعض اكتفى ومن درى الجميع حاز الشرفة. Those three lines of poetry. So inshallah ta'ala, what we will do is I will start with defining what nahw is in grammar, having a bit about it, what does it deal with, what are the benefits, why should I study this field, who is the person who placed this field, how did it come about, and matters like that. So let's first of all start with what's nahw, what does grammar mean? Okay, the word nahw, okay, it means في اللغة, in the language, in the Arabic language, it means al-qasd. In the language, it means al-qasd, is to intend something. لغةً نحو means al-qasd, is to intend something. Also, it means al-jiha, direction. Direction, misdirection, is also nahw, grammar. Al-qasd and al-jiha, direction. So, for example, nahw al-ka'ba. Nahw al-ka'ba, the direction of the ka'ba. Okay? The third one is al-miqdar. Al-miqdar, the amount. Al-miqdar. Amount. So in the Arabic language, the word nahw is used for those three meanings. One, what you intend. Second is the direction. Third is the amount. Okay? For example, when you're talking about the qasd, you say nahawtu nahwaka, ay qasadtu qasdaka. I intend jiha, you mean, you can say tawajjahtu nahwa al-bayt, I face towards the house. Okay, tawajjah, I faced. You can also, when it's the amount, it said indi nahwa alfu dinar. Indi nahwa alfu dinar, I have the amount of alfu dinar. That is what it means lughatan, in the language. Now I want you brothers to learn a principle. The sharia came. And what language is it that the Qur'an and the Sunnah used? Which language did it use? The Arabic language. It took the Arabic language, the usage that the word had, and it added meanings onto it. Or sometimes it reduces a meaning from it. Like for example, the word nahw had a meaning in the language. But then when a scholars come, or when the Sharia comes, it uses the same word, but it adds or subtracts something from it. So that's why it's very important that when you're looking at a word and a group of people have used that word, don't think to yourself, I'm going to look at the word in its linguistic meaning. So now that we learn how linguistically, in that linguistic usage, or the lexical usage, is these three, that doesn't mean that's what it means according to the grammarians. They borrowed the word, and they're now going to use it something that's not far from the language. It's not going to be far from the language, but they're going to add and take from what they want from it. So what does it mean technically? Meaning, what does it mean according to the grammarians? They say is qawa'id, its principles. يُعْرَفُ بِهَا أَحْوَالُ أَوَاخِرِ الْكَلِمَاتِ الْعَرَبِيَةِ. It is principles in which you will know the situations of the ending of the words. إِعْرَابًا وَبِنَاءً. Whether it is إِعْرَاب or whether it is بِنَاء. So what does إِعْرَاب mean and what does بِنَاء mean? We'll come to that. That's what we're going to do, inshallah ta'ala. So pay attention. First of all, grammar is principles. Qawa'id, you're memorizing. So everything I'm going to be teaching you here are principles. So you write them down, it's qawa'id. And I'll keep saying to you, this is a principle, memorize it. It's a principle, memorize it. Okay, also, through principles you get to know something, right? Principles are what allow you to know something, right? But the question here is that, what is it in Nahw that you get to know? Is it the middle of the word, the front of the word, or the ending? Huh? It's the awakhir kal. So the scholars that deal with the ending of the word are the grammarians. The ones who deal with the middle of the word are who? The sarfiyin, the scholars of morphology. Sarf deals with that. But as for grammar, their only concern is what happened to the ending. You with me? Why is it mu instead of ma? Sah? That's their issue. That's what they explain to you. And when the word is grammatically analyzed, it's going to be analyzed through only two ways, either i'rab or bina. So what does i'rab mean? Just write it down as it is right now. What does bina mean? Just write it the way it is right now. We're going to come to that, inshallah. Are you with me, brothers? So we now learn what the definition is. Second point that you need to know. So we finished the definition. The second point that you need to know is what does grammar deal with? Okay, what does this subject deal with? By learning grammar, what am I actually taking on board from it? What you're learning is, first of all, is the Arabic words, al-kalimat al-arabiyyah. Grammar deals with Arabic words. It doesn't deal with French, nor does it deal with English. Okay, for them, grammar here, nahu, doesn't mean English. Okay, nor does it mean French or Spanish. It only means the Arabic language. So it deals with al-kalimat al-arabiyyah, the Arabic words. Second point is, min haythu ma ya'ridhu la hal al-tarkib. The second thing is, the grammarians only observe the word when it is compounded. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? When it becomes compounded. For example, Zayd by itself, grammarians don't really want to know about it. But now when I put it into a sentence, Ja'a Zaydun. Okay, now let's look at Zayd, what's happening here? They don't deal with it when it stands by itself. Zayd by itself is not what they look at, grammarians. But when Zayd is put into a sentence, that's when grammar comes into place. Are you with me? So look at Zayd. What's the ending of the word Zayd? Zayd. What's the ending? How can an ism have sukun? It's called waqf. It's waqf, right? Waqf means we stop. That's it, Zayd. An ism can't have sukun. We'll see that, inshallah ta'ala. So it's called waqf. So what happens to Zayd? Grammarians can't deal with something which is waqf. They can't. That's not their job. Their job is something has to happen at the end, right? It hasn't happened when the word is standing by itself. Are you with me, brothers? So it has to move from being Zayd to what? Zaydu, or Zayda, or Zaydi, right? When that starts happening, Now they start to look at. So the grammarians look at a word when it goes into a context and something takes place at the ending of the word. Are we all on the same page, brothers? Third point that you need to know, are you with me? That he deals with is i'rab and bina. Are you with me, brothers? So al-kalimat al-arabiya bil haythu ma ya'ridu laha hal at-tarkib min al-i'rab wal-bina. Those three. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Are you with me? And tuba'i. And the third one is i'rab and what? Bina. So now I as an individual will not tell you what i'rab means now or what bina means now. We're going to come to that soon, inshallah ta'ala. Now we've understood and we know what? What do we know? What we know is what it deals with and the definition of nahu. Now we're going to move on to the third point. What's the benefit? What am I going to benefit in learning this? Why am I even in this class for? Shouldn't I just go home and relax? No, you shouldn't. Stay here. And the reason why the benefit that it is for you to be here is as follows. Number one, brothers and sisters, learning Arabic is what protects your tongue. Al-ismah. It makes your tongue free from al-khata, from mistakes. Fi kalam al-Arabi, when you speak the Arabic language. You start talking to the people, you're not going to say Ja'a Zayda. Are you with me? I'll ask you guys a sincere question. If somebody spoke to you in English and their English was terrible, can you take them serious? Or do you even, would you take them more as serious as you would take a person who speaks fluently, who's eloquent in his speech? The words he uses are very precise, the way he places his words. Which one would you take much more serious? Second one, right? Isn't that the case? So people won't take you serious. You're doing too many mistakes. People just, and you have to remember, Arabs are just generally arrogant. So it always, by default, is already annoying to some of them, or a lot of them, that you as a foreigner know the Arabic language. So when you play with the language even more, they don't like it now, even more. So, are you with me? Number two, so the first one is al-ismatu ala al-khata al-lisan al-lisaniyu fi al-kalam al-arabi. The second one is wa-ma'rifatu sawabihi bil khata'i. You also know what's right and what's wrong. Okay? Like for example, just by grammatical analysis, I can actually fall into a statement which is aqidah related mistake. Some people just say, oh, that person did a mistake. Some mistakes are not just mistakes, are they? Are they just mistakes? It's not just a mistake. It's not just a mistake. Huh? Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. Who's the one who fears and who is the one who is feared? Allah is feared. Allah is feared, right? Who is the one who fears Allah? The scholars. Isn't that what the ayah is saying? Just by changing the last haraka on both of the words that are used in that sentence, I could change the meaning to Allah is the one who fears the scholars. So now the ayah is, in the correct way, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ. So I turn it into إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهُ. مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءَ is the correct. I change it to الْعُلَمَاءُ. I have now moved the scholars from being the subject to being the what? Huh? To being the object. Are you with me? I didn't do back to front. I didn't change any word. I just changed the grammatical structure of what? Haraka, ya ikhwan. I just changed the haraka only. I have now fallen into a big problem. Isn't it very? Can we say Allah is the one who fears his slaves? Can we say that? We can't say that. So that's how you know when you're leading the prayer. And you do that mistake, it's not just a mistake now. It's not just a mistake now. This mistake is serious. Are you with me? The third benefit that he has is al-isti'alatu ala fahmi kalamillahi ta'ala wa kalami rasulihi. The third one is, it aids you, al-isti'ala ala fahmi kalamillahi ta'ala. It helps you, it aids you in understanding the speech of Allah and the speech of who? The messenger. Brothers, by studying grammar, it will help you to understand Allah's speech, and it will help you to understand the speech of who? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So those are three benefits that it has to study it. And also, brothers, the scholars realize that. They realize that by unanimous, there's no khilaf. The need for grammar, how serious it is. And I know all of you here don't want to be blind followers for the rest of your life. Do you all just want to be blind followers? And if somebody tells you something's halal, you just say, oh, it's halal. Haram, no, it's haram. Or do you really want to be a person who goes to the Quran and the Sunnah yourself, reach that level where you can extract warnings? Isn't that something you all want to be? Isn't that the mindset that you need to work towards? Isn't that the... Huh, brothers? Well, you're not going to reach that if you don't know grammar. And it's a consensus that a person cannot reach the level of ijtihad, which means he can't go to the textual evidence, the Quran and the Sunnah, and extract rulings from it if he has not mastered the grammar. Let me read some statements for you. Al-Imam Abu al-Barakat al-Albani rahimahullah, he says, إِنَّ الْأَئِمَّةِ the scholars, مِنَ السَّلَفِ وَالْخَلَفِ from the pious predecessors at the time of the Salaf, and the A'imma who came after the pious predecessors, after the three noble generation, after them, وَالْخَلَفْ أَجْمَعُوا قَاطِبَةً, they all agreed and unanimously, no dispute, عَلَى أَنَّهُ شَرْطٌ, that is a condition, فِي رُتْبَةِ الْإِجْتِهَاد, to reach the level of ijtihad. وَأَنَّ الْمُجْتَهِدَ, and that the person of ijtihad, which is the person who is deriving rulings from the Qur'an and the Sunnah directly, وَأَنَّ الْمُجْتَهِدَ لَوْ جَمَعَ كُلَّ الْعُلُومِ, that if he gathers all of the other sciences, if the mujtahid attains and gains all of the other knowledge sciences, لَمْ يَبْلُغْ, he won't reach رُتْبَةُ الْإِجْتِهَاد, the level of ijtihad, حَتَّى يَعْلَمَ النَّحْوَى, until he knows grammar. He knows usul fiqh. He knows qira'at, he knows mustalah, he knows this, he knows that. He is mutamakkin in all of the sciences, just doesn't know grammar. Has he reached the level of rutbatul ijtihad? Has he? He's not reached. This is a consensus. لَمْ يَخْتَلِفْ فِي إِثْنَانُ مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, two Muslims have not differed upon this from the ulama. Are you with me, brothers? Are you with me, sisters? This is very important. The other point is, it's also the condition of a mufti. If you want to give fatwa and respond and answer questions directly from the Quran and the Sunnah, grammar is a condition. Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi rahimahullah, Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, who is the great Imam in the Madhab al-Shafi'iyya, he said, وَيَعْرِفُ بِاللُّغَةِ وَالنَّحْوِ مَا يَعْرِفُ بِهِ مُرَادَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَمُرَادَ رَسُولِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي خِطَابِهِمَا, that the person learns the language and he also learns grammar. How much do I have to learn from grammar? And how much do I have to learn from the language? Brothers and sisters, as there is extremism in everything, there's also extremism in sciences. You find some people, they don't even want to learn a science. They'll just belittle it. I don't want to learn it. And you put that science down. The poet said, أَتَانَا أَنَّ سَهْلًا ذَمَّ جَهْلًا عُلُومًا لَيْسَ يَعْرِفُهُنَّ سَهْلُ عُلُومًا لَوْ دَرَاهَا مَا قَلَاهَا وَلَكِنَّ الرِّضَى بِالْجَهْلِ سَهْلُ. It has reached us, أَتَانَا أَنَّ سَهْلًا, this man سَهْلْ, ذَمَّ جَهْلًا, he belittled a science in the religion, or he belittled a science. عُلُومًا لَيْسَ يَعْرِفُهُنَّ سَهْلُ, it is a science that سَهْلْ doesn't know. عُلُومًا لَوْ دَرَاهَا مَا قَلَاهَا, It's a subject, a science. لو دراها, if he knew it, ما قلاها, أي ما أبغضها. He would not have hated it. He would not have hated it. But ولكن الرضا بالجهل سهل. But to be pleased with ignorance is one of the easiest things to do, right? But it's funny, the poetry is very good because the first part is talking about سهل, which is easy, and at the last time, the beginning is talking about سهل, which is him, and at the ending is talking about easy. Then he's going against his name. You should see everything easy and do it and embark on it and take it on and do it. So sometimes you're going to find people come up to you and say, what are you doing? Study grammar. Go for aqidah. Go for aqidah. Are you with me, brothers? Just go for aqidah. What are you doing? Quran, Qiraat. Stop wasting your time. Are you with me, brothers? That doesn't mean I'm belittling sha'n al-aqidah and tawheed, and you know I wouldn't. But why would you belittle another science for? Sah? Are you with me? It shows you're ignorant of the science and you don't know the value of it. That's why you. Are you with me, brothers? So, how much do I have to know of grammar? And as I said, grammar is like anything. There's extremism. Extremism what? In negligence. Some people are just going to say, I don't want to know it. I don't want to study Nahu. I don't want to study anything. Leave me alone. And another person is going to go what? Extreme in going into the science. And it's so extreme that it loses the beauty that it had. And Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali has a book called Fadl al-Ilm al-Salafi ala Ilm al-Khalaf, where he talks about the virtue of the knowledge of the pious predecessors and the latecomers. And when he speaks there, he says that grammar is like salt. If you add too much salt to your food, how does it taste? What about if you don't add no salt to your food? Grammar is like that. Too much is no good. Too little is no good. Some people ta'abbuq. Too much into grammar, and it's too much. Hey, all I needed from grammar was what? As the author here said, بَيَعْرِفُ بِهِ مُرَادَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَىٰ, to understand what Allah is saying to me. Okay? وَمُرَادَ رَسُولِهِ, and what the Prophet ﷺ is intending when he says, فِي خِطَارِهِمَا. Are you with me, brothers? That's all, that's enough. That's what you need. Are you with me, brothers? Khalid al-Azhari, Imam Khalid al-Azhari. By the way, Khalid al-Azhari has a story. Khalid al-Azhari embarked on learning grammar at an old age. He's an Egyptian, you can see Azhari. He lived in Egypt. And what he used to do was, he used to pour tea for the students in the Jami'ah, in Azhar, Egypt. You know? And he wanted to get a reward from this, feeding the students, helping the students. So what he did was one day, he poured tea by accident. As he was pouring it, he poured on one of the students' notes and his, you know, his paper and his book. And the student looked and he said, what are you doing, you jahil? He said to him, what did you say? Jahil, what are you doing? He realized that even though this individual who insulted him said something very painful, he embarked on the path of learning grammar. حَتَّى صَارَ إِمَامٌ. He became an imam in the field of grammar. صح, brothers? Yeah? Khalid al-Azhari. The kitab مُؤَصِّلُ الطُّلَّابِ فِي قَوَاعِدِ الْإِعْرَابِ, written by the great author Ibn Hisham al-Ansari rahimahullah. He's the one who explained that book. قَوَاعِدُ الْإِعْرَابِ, he explained it, he called it مُؤَصِّلُ الطُّلَّابِ أَمَا مُوصِلُ الطُّلَّابِ, both ways you can say it. He said something very powerful now. Look, he is now seeing how serious the language is. He said, إِنَّ مَعْرِفَةِ الْإِعْرَابِ, knowing grammar, مِنَ الْوَاجِبَاتِ الَّتِي لَا بُدَّ لِكُلِّ طَالِبِ عِلْمٍ مِنْهَا. It is obligatory for every student of knowledge to come with. وَمِنَ الْمُهِمَّاتِ الَّتِي لَا يَسْتَغْنِي الْفَقِيهُ عَلَىٰ. And it is also from the important things that a jurist cannot be without. And I told you guys, and I've said this many times, that Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, what did he say when he learned that language? And they came up to him and they said to Shafi'i, why are you learning the language? Why are you memorizing so much poetry? What is the purpose behind it? His response was, لِأَخْدُمَ الْفِقْهَ, right? So I can serve fiqh. Al-Imam Sharafuddin al-Imrati rahimahullah, in his Nadhm, he made this book that we're reading right now, he turned it into poetry so the person can memorize it in a poetic form. If it's hard for you to memorize this, you can go to Sharafuddin al-Imrati and memorize his poetry version. He says, وَالنَّحْوُ أَوْلَىٰ أَوَّلًا أَن يُعْلَمَا إِذِ الْكَلَامُ دُونَهُ لَن يُفْهَمَا. He says, Nahu, grammar, is more befitting for you to know it, because speech cannot be understood without it. God. Also, the other person who said, النَّحْوُ زَيْنُ لِلْفَتَىٰ, grammar is the beauty of a person, it beautifies you. يُقْرِبُهُ حَيْثُ أَتَىٰ, and it will honor you wherever you come. مَنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ يَعْرِفُهُ, anyone who doesn't know grammar, فَحَقُّهُ أَنْ يَسْكُتَىٰ, his right is to be quiet. Just be quiet. Don't you know grammar? No, be quiet. That's the rights of that person. I mean, that's the way he should be. Be quiet. If you don't know grammar, be quiet. And the scholars, they would never, ever think of teaching or taking knowledge from anyone who does not know grammar. Who was the first person, barakallahu fi? Who was the first person who placed grammar? The first person who placed grammar and who put it, which is the next point, is Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali. Abu al-Du'li, that's how both ways are said. And they say he wrote it by the command of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And Ali was the one who coined the name grammar. This word, Nahu, was coined by who? Ali ibn Abi Talib. He actually was the one who gave this word, Nahu. And the way he did that was by what? He came to Abu Aswad, who was a Tabi'i, and he said, write. When Ali ibn Abi Talib saw that the people were learning the language and there was so much grammatical mistakes in what they were saying, so what he did was he said, Ali ibn Abi Talib said, radiallahu ta'ala, he said, uktub, write. And he told him, al-kalam, speech, is divided into, al-kalima, is divided into this much. And he wrote it. And then he said, inhi hadha nahu, and carry on in that way. Carry on in that way. So the word nahu got taken from there. You with me? That's what they say. Those people say that. He said to him, inhu hadha nahu ya abul aswad. Last but not least, where is the Arabic language taken from? And what is it taken from? When we take the... Are you there? When we use grammar, rules and regulations, where are we finding these rules from? Is it somebody dreamt, he woke up and he said, look, by the way, this is that? No. It's taken from the Quran, and it is also taken from what? No, it's not taken from the Sunnah. It's not taken from the Sunnah. Grammar is not taken from the Hadith of the Prophet. It's taken from the Kalam of the Arab, the Arab speech. And the Arab's speech which is taken is before Islam. Anyone after Islam's Arabic, we don't take into consideration. You can use it if you wish to, but it's not hujjah in it, it's not proof. The reason is because when the Messenger came, this was the language that was used. When the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam died, the language got tainted. So the language got tainted. Somalis started entering into the religion. When the Somalis came, they came with their little bandages. Somalis, when they say thumma, they don't mean their tongue out. They don't say thumma, they say summa. Why you guys, you Asians, it's not like you, well, you think you guys haven't come with a bandage as well? You guys came with love. So the language started to get tainted. So scholars don't really take it as a proof. Like for example, Abu Tayyib al-Mutanabbi. Abu Tayyib al-Mutanabbi was late. His ash'ar and his poetry, you can kind of enjoy it and mention he said this and that. But when it comes to a usage of a word, Abu Tayyib al-Mutanabbi is not. Abu Atahiyya, the licensed people. No. Are you there? You say Imru Uqais. The mushrik said, his language is fasih. Fasih. Pure. That was the language Rasulullah came, I was using. Sahab brothers, Why is it that we can't use the head sunnah? Why did I say that? You can't say Rasulullah said this, so grammatically you're allowed to say this. What? Why? Jameel. Hadith has what is known as al-riwayatu bil-ma'na. The Prophet's wordings, sometimes the companions will narrate the meaning, not the wording. So, they would narrate the Prophet's meaning of what he said, not the wording. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he is the one who, other scholars say, no, we're going to use what the Prophet said, it's a proof, khalas. Are you there? But some scholars, they say no. The author of this book, his name is Al-Imam Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Dawood al-Sunhaji al-Shahir ibn Ajurrum. He's very well known as Ajurrum. That's why the book is called Ajurumiyah. Okay, Ajurumiyah comes from what? It's the author's name. The author's name is called Ajurrum. Okay, and so the book got called what? Ajurumiyah. Just like if Ibn Baz wrote a book, scholars will call it Baziyya. So that's all it is. It's not that the word, the book Ajurumiyah is an Arabic term now and it's got grammatical analysis to it. No, it's just the book's named after him. Okay? Fadal.